Hello all, good to see you. Anke Mulman here. Our website is cwowi.eu and it stands for Church Without Walls International. We are part of a network of house churches, a worldwide network. If you are interested about house church or about relationship-based faith, go to our website or go to another website where we are part of cwowi.org. There are a lot of articles and a lot of information about house church, but my Facebook video are about certain subjects, a little bit of a teaching or something that I am thinking about. And today I want to talk to you about have a need, sow a seed. So actually it's about money today. So maybe you've heard that expression, when you have a need, you have to sow a seed. We were part of the stream of the faith that those things were taught and we understood them at that time, and we oftentimes did that, those things. We sow something in order to receive something. But later on, you know, there was always in our spirit something like, this is not quite right, and we couldn't put our finger on it because scriptures were mentioned, and you think, yeah, it's in the word. But we knew something was wrong, and what was wrong, I will talk about that. But okay, let me say it from the start. I do believe as a Christian, you must be a giver. It's good to give. It's good to give money. It's good to give your time, your resources. You give love, whatever. Be a giver. God is a giver, and we are made after his likeness and his image. So we should be a giver too. Not be concerned about our own needs only, but be concerned about the needs of others too. But have a need, sow a seed means, for instance, if you have a big bill and that you can't pay, so you have to sow a seed, sow some money somewhere, and then you have to. You can expect a harvest from that seed. The seed is always small, the harvest is big. So when you sow a certain amount of money, you can expect more money. And the scripture that is used oftentimes comes from Galatians chapter 6:7, where Paul says, whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. Whatever. So the idea is, so whatever you sow, that will you will reap. Whatever you sow. So if you sow money, you will reap money. And the seed is always small and the harvest is always big. So a little bit of money, you will receive a lot of money. And I even saw people sowing watches in the, what do you say, watches? Yeah, watches, you know, watches in the offering box, because they had, I don't know, 2-3 watches at home, and they needed a bigger watch and they needed a better watch. Or needed, they wanted a bigger or a better watch. So they thought, okay, let me sow this old one and then I can expect another watch, because whatever a man sows, that he will reap. I've seen people sowing a car, an old car, because they wanted a better car. And so many things. I think, okay, so what was eventually happening in those lives? And if you are not careful, it will happen in your own life, that you become so busy with money and getting things that you sow and you give because you want to get. Because you give because you want to have. And I don't see that in the Word. I see in the Word that we should be givers, but that we should be givers because we love the Lord, because we love him, and because we love our brothers and sisters, and that's why we want to give. I never see that there must be that we give because we want to get, because that's very dangerous. And I even know Christians who had a notebook with them, and when they saw money, they wrote it down, like, okay, let's say today is, I don't know, let's say it's the 1st of October 2019, and I sow $20 or 20 euros into that ministry. So they kept track of it, and when they received some money from someone else, then I always wondered, how do you know, like when you get 100 euros from someone or $100, how do you know that is that is from a seed that you have sown like some time ago? How do you know? But they were tracking it, and then they say, okay, I've sown so many much, so now I can expect that much money, because this what you reap is always more than what you sow. So the result of the teaching is that you give about receiving, and greed comes in, and people do not look to the Lord to provide the needs, but it's all about their efforts and their works, and they name their seed, and they call their seed, and they pray over their seed. I think it's fine when you pray, say, Lord, be led by the Holy Spirit. You know, when I do believe when there is a need and God speaks to you that you sow something or that you give someone what money or something else, and then you feel led to do it, please do so, because God knows how to take care of your need. And actually, you see that in the book of Philippians. That's a scripture that we all know and that we all love, and that is, okay, now my God shall supply all your needs. That's what Paul is saying. And we love it, my God shall supply all my needs. But when you go to the book of Philippians in verse 15, Paul says, no church shared with me concerning giving and receiving, but you only. Even in Thessalonica, you sent once and again for my necessities. So those the Philippians were givers. They gave into his ministry. And then Paul says, okay, and now my God shall supply all of your need. And that is true. When you give, it will be given back to you. That's the principle. God sowed his son, and he gained many sons and daughters, so to speak. He gave his son, and he gained many sons and daughters. So I believe in the principle of sowing, and that you will reap at a certain point. When you go to Galatians, whatever a man sows, that he will reap. Paul talks about when you sow to your flesh, you will reap corruption. But when you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life. Of course, there it has a consequence. It's what you do, what you look at, what you read about. Of course, when you sow into that, you will reap from it. But the idea that whatever you sow, it will come back to you. I don't know. That's very weird to me, and I've seen many people being hurt by it. We've seen people who were poor, who were giving and giving and giving and expecting money to come back to them, but it never came. And then, of course, ministers say you have to sow in good ground, then you will have a good harvest. So, and of course, the good ground is, of course, the minister and whatever. And those ministers, they have big houses and big cars because everyone sows into their ministry because they want to have a big harvest. You know, but giving is about being led by the Lord because you love him, and then you give out to others. When you go first let me read this in Timothy. I read it just a couple of minutes ago where Paul says to Timothy, he says, having food and clothing, with these we shall be content. But those who desire to be rich, you know, sometimes the desire creeps in to be rich, they fall into temptation and a snare and into many foolish and harmful lusts. And then he says in verse 10, for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. So the lust of money, it can become a lust. You lust for money and you look, how can you sow so that you can have some more money? Well, that is very dangerous. What do we see in well, of course, in Acts chapter 2, when you read about the first disciples, you know, they gave. Acts 2, 44 and 45, it says, all who believed were together, they had all things in common. They sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone has need. There was a need, so they gave because they loved one another. Acts 4 mentioned the same things, that they sold them, laid it to the apostles' feet, and they distributed them to each as anyone has need. And of course, you know also the story about Ananias and Sapphira, how they were judged by the Lord for their hypocrisy and for their lying. They sold some stuff, land, and they could do with the money whatever they desired, but they gave the idea that they gave everything, the whole price of the land that they had sold. So that would look good, right? It was like, wow, they gave everything, but that was not true. They kept the back part of it, and that was okay if they were honest about it. So the Lord had to judge them because the whole body of Christ was still in Jerusalem. Yeah, okay, what else can we say about money? 2 Corinthians 8, I don't know how much time I have. I do have a couple of minutes. 2 Corinthians 8, it talks about, about the churches of Macedonia. Paul says, their deep poverty abounded in the riches of their liberty, and I bear witness that according to their ability, yeah, and beyond their ability, they were freely willing. And then it says, okay, and not only as we have hoped, but they first gave themselves to the Lord and then to us by the will of God. So you first give yourself to the Lord and then you will have a heart for the others too. And then it says in verse 12, if there is a willing mind, it is accepted to what one has, not according to what he does not have. For I do not mean that others should be eased and you be burdened, but by an equality that now at this time your abundance may supply their lack, that their abundance also may supply your lack, that there may be equality. So he says, if you don't have money, you don't have to give. But if you do have, of course, please help those others that don't have money, so there is an equality. Is it possible that sometimes the Lord leads you to give out of a need? Yes, of course, but be led by the Spirit. For instance, in Melchizedek, of course, Abraham, he gave to Melchizedek 10% of what he had, but it came out of his heart. He gave it voluntarily, not because he wanted money, but because it was in his heart. In 1 Kings 17, when you read about a widow at Zarephath, there it says, I have it right here, let me see, let me read it. Elijah was there, and the word of the Lord came to Elijah and said, go and dwell there, because I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. So he went there to the widow, and he told the widow, well, the Lord has spoken it to me. He said, do not fear, but make me a small cake and bring it to me. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry. Okay, so she was acting upon the word of the Lord. And she didn't have much, and she gave it, that's true. But she acted upon the word of the Lord. And that's the point. So in your giving, and if you have a need, spend time with the Lord. See what he says about it. He is your provider, right? And if you are a giver, if you give money, if you give from what you have, you know, time, whatever, to the body of Christ, to those in need, the Lord will make sure that your needs will also be met. But do not give because to get. Check your motives, because it's very dangerous, and greediness can creep in, and the lust of money can be there. And that's a very dangerous thing. I hope you understand what I'm saying about it. I'm just rambling a little bit, but that was something I was thinking about because I came across some of that teaching the last couple of days. So I hope it helped you. Let me know what you think about it. Bye-bye.